Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to today's colloquia. I've been given the privilege of introducing our speaker today because I've known him for longer than anybody else in the room, I believe. We met when we were both at UVA doing our PhDs. We met probably about 2 days after I got there because I had a roommate that was in the astronomy department and knew Phil. And then the following year, we actually became roommates, and we were in a house of five of us, which are most of the memories actually from UVA or from that house and how cold it was. but after Phil finished his PhD, he actually became part of the NASA family and worked at Goddard for 5 years. And it was when he was at Goddard that he actually started up a website, Bad Astronomy. And that kind of kicked off his life in what he's doing now in science communication. But that website actually became a book, or became parts of a book, and is also a kind of drove him into the Hollywood life, if you will. Got him as a science consultant for Mythbusters. And now his latest endeavor, he's going to be the lead science writer for Bill Nye, thank you. I was going back to old school for the science communication, but so he's that Bill Nye show starts up in this spring. You have any date for that?
No, just the spring's all I know.
Okay,
they don't tell me anything. I just help write the show. Yeah.
Good. That better off to stay dumb and happy with it.
Yeah,
as long as the checks come, that's all that matters. So with no further ado, I'd like to introduce Dr. Phil Plait.
Thanks. Howdy, everybody. Oh, I guess I don't need this. Can you all hear me? It's on, right? I can't tell from here. Yeah, it's a pleasure to be here, and thanks, Steve. When I heard Steve was here, it kind of cracked me up. I mean, that was sort of years ago, and it's kind of funny how the memories rush back. As you said, you have a lot of memories of that house, and a lot of things I don't remember from that house, which is probably all for the best, for that matter. And it's a great pleasure to be here. I've been to a few NASA centers over the past few years. I've not been to Langley yet. And so this place is pretty impressive. We went to see the wind tunnels. And if you like big fans, that's a very cool place. It was really interesting. I really liked it. So I'm very, very, very happy to be here. And it's a pleasure. And especially to talk about something that's going on in the sky, because that's kind of what NASA is all about. A lot of the talks I give are debunkings, as Steve implied, talking about misconceptions about astronomy. I'll be talking about a few of them here, but it's kind of nice, it's almost a relief to talk about something real, some real science, something pretty interesting. And the beauty of talking about this eclipse, too, is that unless you've seen one or unless you've done a lot of reading, there's always some stuff here that you may not know about. So I'm hoping that even if you understand about eclipses, there's going to be a couple of things in here that may surprise you. And now that I say this, is there any way we could maybe turn these lights down? Do you know, Rob? Is it me? Oh, I get to. Oh, well. Here. All right, let's see.
Keep on going.
Oh, nailed it in one. All right. You know, the only space shuttle launch I ever saw launched on time. They're doing the countdown, 5, 4, 3, and they got to 3, and I went, 3? That means they're going to do it, and it took off, and it's like, yeah, so apparently I should be hanging out with NASA more often. Stuff gets done on the first try. So, total solar eclipses. There's going to be a fantastic opportunity to see a total solar eclipse in the coming year, on August 21st in 2017. What is an eclipse? How do these happen? What's going on? How do you view it? How can you not view it? Which turns out is an important thing to talk about, and I will talk about that. But first, like I said, there's always something you may not know about eclipses, and I want to start right off with one. I'm going to start off with the word syzygy. Have you all heard this word before? Oh, yeah, you're smiling and nodding, yeah, but I bet a lot of you haven't. It's the problem with giving a talk at NASA is they're all like, well, of course we've heard of syzygy. What are you talking? Of course we have. I love this word, and not just because it's worth, I believe, 23 points in Words with Friends at a minimum. But you'll need a blank tile because there's only two Ys. I could think about this a little more, but I won't. for those of you who haven't played Words with Friends. This is a great word because it's so odd. But it's got a fairly simple definition. It's just simply when three astronomical bodies line up. Now, this doesn't happen terribly often where you have three things exactly on a line. Depending on the objects, when you're talking about for an eclipse, it doesn't happen very often. There are times it does happen all the time. For example, when you're looking at one of the giant outer planets like Saturn, and it's got moons. Oh, I can walk around. I've got a portable mic. You can see there's Titan here and a couple of other moons. These moons are casting their shadows. Because you can see the moon physically in front of the planet, that means the planet and the moon and us, the Earth, are in a line. Now, this picture is taken from Hubble. I had a moment where I thought it was taken by the Cassini spacecraft, and I thought, oh, that's actually orbiting Saturn. So that's not technically a syzygy, because that's a space probe and not an astronomical object. But in fact, this was taken from Earth. So if you guys are the Earth looking at this, the planet and the moons line up. That was a really nice triple syzygy. Jupiter, not to be outdone, there's also this picture. I love this one, too, where you have three moons here that you can see, and it turns out there are two more that you can't see. I think there's a shadow of one here. There's another one in there. They're two tiny little moons. This is actually a quintuple syzygy. Technically, these are called transits. When a small object passes in front of a bigger one, we call it a transit. If the smaller object gets big enough that it starts to cover a majority of the object, we call it an eclipse. Not really hard and fast definitions. An eclipse is technically a transit. Not all transits are eclipses, right? So a square is a rectangle, but not all rectangles are squares, that kind of thing. Astronomers have a lot of this sort of shorthand words that we've used for the past 300 years or whatever, and they make it into the modern dialect, and they may not be that accurate, but we use them out of habit, and astronomers are lazy. You heard it here last. Now that I see it. Yeah, I knew that there was a fourth one. I knew there were four moons here. So Saturn had four, Jupiter had five, because Jupiter's bigger. It's going to outdo Saturn. So for an eclipse on the Earth, what do you need? Well, there are three things you need for an eclipse. You need the sun. Hello. Of course. That's actually a photograph I took with a small solar telescope that I have, and I'll show you a picture of that later because it's actually pretty neat. If you want to view an eclipse with it, it's actually a pretty cool way to do it. You need the Earth, and can you guess? Can you guess what the third one is? Yeah, it's the moon, of course. That's actually not a photo of the moon. That is a visualization constructed from Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter data done at the Goddard Space Flight Center. I love it. If you've ever seen this, I've got something else showing it later. But they every year. And I haven't seen it yet for 2017. Now that I think about it. But every year they put out a phases of the moon for the next year where they have this visualization showing the phases versus time and the angle of the moon and everything. And they're stunning, stunning videos. Photorealistic. You'd swear it's an actual photo of the moon. That's not it. So how does this work? Well, imagine you have the Earth here and the moon going around it. This is not to scale. Right? The moon is a quarter of the size of the Earth, quarter of the diameter, and it's actually very far away from the Earth, but to show you here, it'll be like this. You're sort of kind of looking straight down on it, not really, you're kind of at an angle. The moon orbits the Earth in a pretty decent circle. We'll put the sun up that way so it's shining down from the top, and on the right is going to be the phase of the moon, given the position of the moon around the Earth. Now, I can't do it that way. Can't just stop it. It's hard to. There we go. I'll just let it run. So when the moon gets between the Earth and the sun, we're seeing the dark side of it, and you see that the moon is mostly dark. When it's over here on the other side, we're seeing the fully lit side. So there's new, first quarter, full, third quarter. And you can repeat this, ad infinitum, or at least for 4.5 billion years, which is the way things have been going so far, and we'll go on for a long time. I guess I have this looped. Okay, excellent. There we go. All right. Wasn't sure if that was going to work. So as the moon moves around the Earth, that's why we have phases. You all probably know this. There's a lot of details in here that aren't terribly important. But when you show something like this to people who don't know about this, especially to school kids, there's a natural question that comes up. And that is, if the moon is going around the Earth and we're seeing it completely black at new moon and full at full moon, why don't we have an eclipse? Why isn't the moon covering the sun every 2 weeks? It takes a month for the Earth, for the moon to go around the Earth. It's where the word month comes from. It's moon, month, moonth. Why don't we get a solar eclipse at new moon every 2 weeks, and then 2 weeks later get a lunar eclipse where the moon is blocked by the Earth 2 weeks later? And the answer has to do with the third dimension. You can look at a nice clock like this, pretty fancy schmancy clock. If you were to watch this clock for 25 minutes, nothing will happen because now that I think about it, it's a picture of a clock. It's not going to change. But if you have an actual clock, and it's not a digital clock, the big hand's going to go around faster than the little hand. And in this case, in a little over 20 minutes, the big hand and the little hand are going to cross. And of course, the little hand's moving around as well. So it's not exactly 20 minutes. It's like a little bit after 2 o'clock. The two hands will be on top of each other, and they'll pass each other. They'll be in a line. And so you kind of have a I guess that would be a little hand eclipse. Just thought of that. That's kind of funny. I like that. I'll have to remember that. But is that really true? And the answer is, well, no. I mean, yeah, sure, it's blocking your view, but it's not physically hitting the other hand. And why is that? It's because, well, they're not actually in the same plane. They're not lined up with each other. And the same thing is true with the moon. The moon's orbit around the Earth is tilted about 5 degrees from the Earth's orbit around the sun, which we call the ecliptic. We're actually, if you look at the Earth's orbit, it's an ellipse, but it, you know, on these kind of scales, if you were to draw it, it's almost a perfect circle. And so it's in a plane, and since we're in that plane, we see it as a line across the sky. That's the path of the sun every year. As the Earth goes around the sun, we see the sun moving around the sky from the Earth, and that path that it moves across is called the ecliptic. And the Earth is tilted about 23 degrees from that, but the moon's orbit is tilted about 5 degrees from that, so about 18 degrees from the Earth's equator. And that is why we don't have an eclipse every 2 weeks. Because of this tilt, when the moon is over here, for example, this is drawn, I guess, the wrong way now that I think about it, but if the sun were over that way, the moon would actually be up too high. It would pass above the sun in the sky and not block it. The moon has to physically pass between the Earth and the sun to get an eclipse. And it won't always do that. This is a much better diagram here, which again, this is from NASA Scientific Visualization Studio at Goddard Space Flight Center. If you picture that the green square is the plane of the Earth's orbit around the sun, you can pretend it's much larger. The sun is this way to the left. And the blue circle represents the plane of the moon's orbit, and then the circle that you see is actually the moon. And you can see the Earth in the center and the moon there off to the right. Now I can put this in motion. Woohoo! So a month is every few seconds. Now in this case, it looks like you should have an eclipse. Boom, right there. The moon should get between the Earth and the sun. However, as we zoom in and then come down, you'll see that, the moon's orbit is tilted. And so as it goes around, the shadow doesn't always pass in front of the Earth. As the Earth moves around the sun, though, eventually it'll get to a point where the moon's orbit intersects the plane of the Earth's orbit, and then you can get an eclipse. And that's what is shown right there. We can show this a little bit better from here. Now, these diagrams, the reason I love these diagrams is they are to scale. The moon is a quarter of the diameter of the Earth, and it's, I want to say, 30 times farther away from the Earth than the Earth's size. So if the Earth is this big, the moon is 30 of these away. The best way to think about it, it's shockingly far. If the Earth were a basketball, the moon would be a tennis ball to scale, and it would be roughly 10 meters away, 30 feet, if you use feet, like I know some of you do here for some reason. Metrics is the way to go. So it's roughly 10 meters away, something like that. And so it's surprisingly far. And so that's what's shown here. I love this, the geometry here. And that shows you that the moon's shadow from the sun is actually a very long, thin cylinder that is sweeping around in space. It's always out there. It just so happens that the geometry has to line up just right for that shadow to fall across the Earth. And that's what you saw in the last one, that it usually misses. But sometimes it works. And so in this video, this animation, This is what's going to happen in August of next year, August 21st, that the geometry, the dance of all of this is going to line up just right, that the moon's shadow is going to sweep across the Earth just as you see it there. Now, before I talk about that and the eclipse, what I want you to notice here is that there are two shadows. I don't mean the Earth's and the moon's. I mean the moon seems to cast two shadows. There's sort of this faint one that is more like a cylinder going out, but then there's this dark one which converges like a cone. It's actually cone-shaped. And it's that one that is landing right on the Earth. Why are there two shadows? Well, I have a very confusing diagram to explain this. The reason there are two shadows is because the sun is not a point source. If the sun were just a dot in the sky, then it would cast a perfectly parallel shadow on the moon. The moon's shadow would be a cylinder that would extend off forever, more or less. But it's not. Because the sun actually has a physical size, and the moon has roughly the same size as well, which I'll talk about in a moment, the shadowing is a little bit more confusing. This is not to scale in any sense at all. the sun is actually 400 times physically wider than the moon. And it's actually very, very, very far away. Turns out 400 times farther away from the moon, which is why this is important. But this is just to give you an idea. If you were out here in space, and let, you know, the Earth is over here someplace, doesn't matter. Suppose you're floating near the moon. If you're right here, your view to the sun is unimpeded. There's the sun, boom, in the sky, fully lit, everything's great. But if you were to move over here and look, this part of the moon would be blocking this part of the sun. You know, that blue line connects them. So if you're right here, part of the sun is blocked by the moon. So now you're seeing sort of a piece of it cut out, and where you're standing isn't as illuminated as where you were a minute ago. I guess you wouldn't be standing, you'd be floating, and you wouldn't be floating, you'd just be dead because you're out in space. Get to work on that, NASA people. So if you're here, this part of space isn't quite as bright as here. And as you move in, you're seeing more and more of the sun blocked by the moon. And then if you're in between these two red lines, then your view of the sun is completely blocked. So I can put my hand up like that, and that's what I'm sort of seeing. The entire light source, the sun, is blocked by the moon. This is called the umbra, which is Latin for shadow. The term umbrella comes from that. You're shadowing yourself with an umbrella, or shadowing yourself from sunlight. Then it's called a parasol, which means like the sun, maybe? I don't know. Now I'm just making stuff up. But it also blocks the rain, too. It puts you in the shadow of the rain. I kind of like to think of it that way. Out here, where you're only blocking some of the sunlight, is called the penumbra, which means close to shadow or almost shadowed, depending on how you translate your Latin. So that's why there are two shadows, because the sun has a physical size, and it takes a while for the moon to block it completely. So there are more and less shadowed regions. And this one's kind of neat, too. If you go out past this point to here, the moon is actually, you're far enough away from the moon that it appears smaller. It can't block the sun completely, even when it's directly in front of the sun. And you get what's called an annular eclipse, which means a ring. And so that area of the umbra, penumbra, triumvirate, just made that up too, is called the antumbra, behind the umbra. And that is fascinating to me. I didn't realize that until a few years ago, as I was actually playing with this, trying to figure this all out, trying to figure out some shadowing effects from a different eclipse. I realized, it's like, oh my gosh, there's this whole region. And then I looked it up, and it turns out, yeah, it exists, and it's called the antumbra. I like learning stuff. So what does this mean? If you are standing on the Earth, and you have a nice telescope, and you're looking at it, every now and again, usually the moon misses, but every now and again things line up just right. And again, this is an animation, this isn't actually a photograph. The moon will pass directly in front of the sun like this. And a lot of things happen when that happens. You can tell this is an animation because you can see some detail on the moon. In fact, when the moon is that close to the sun is so bright and the moon is so dark, you're just seeing a perfectly black disk. You are not seeing any details. That animation is interesting just to show you what you see perfectly with no atmospheric effects, nothing, whatever. But you can actually see what this actually looks like from this video, which was taken in Australia a few years back. This is moments before a total eclipse. I love this video. It's kind of shaky and everything. So you can see the dark moon there. You can see just passing in front of the sun and boom, total. So now this is a total eclipse. And you saw the bright flare of the sun. That was the little last bit of the sun's surface that you were seeing right here. So the moon is moving this way in the sky. And on top of that, the Earth is spinning. And so, you know, the sun is rising and setting. The moon is with it. So they're sort of rising and setting together. But at the same time, the moon is moving across the sun. All these motions together gets a little confusing and hard to figure out. But the last bit of the sun there, when that happens, when you have that sort of bright region of the sun and the rest of it's dark, it's called the diamond ring effect. It's not that strong in this video because a lot of the times you can still see pieces of the sun around the moon. The moon's surface is irregular. It's not a perfect sphere. It's got mountains and valleys and craters. Oh my. And sometimes, even though the perfect circle of the moon would block the sun, if there's a crater or a valley or something right on the limb, that'll let some of the sun surface through. And so you'll get a beautiful effect of bright dots around the moon or a line. And so that if you have that line in the bright spots called a diamond ring effect, the bright spots are called Bailey's beads. Francis Bailey was an astronomer in the 1800s, was the first one to figure out what this meant, that you're seeing sunlight past the moon. So now here, totality is ending. The surface of the sun is back. And all of this bright light here is not just glare. That is actually the corona. That's the atmosphere of the sun, the very thin outer atmosphere of the sun. It's gas that it's blowing out. It's strongly affected by the sun's magnetic field. This was not a part of the sun that was understood at all, I should say, until recently. We don't really understand it completely right now. It's very complex. But nobody had any idea this even existed, or they wouldn't have had any idea it existed if we didn't have eclipses. The moon blocks the sun and allows this corona to be seen. It is extremely thin, extremely faint. The sun is millions of times brighter, probably more than that. The sun is over 100,000 times brighter than the full moon, so it's millions of times brighter than the corona. So it's completely invisible until you block the sun like this. And nature provides us with the ability to do that. So that's sort of the basics of the eclipse. And I do want to say, you know what, I'll end with it. Never mind. I'll get back to that. I'll just tease you a little bit. Something cool about eclipses that I'll get back to. All right, so that's how these things work. That's how they're set up. That's sort of the geometry and the physics of it. What's going to happen on August 21st, 2017? It turns out a lot. I love being alive today. I used to give talks where I had to use, you know, lantern slides or overheads or whatever. Now I can go online and say, NASA, show me what this eclipse is going to look like. And they're like, all right, here you go. Here's the video you need. These are fantastic animations of the physical nature of the eclipse that's going to happen in 9 months. 9 months? 9 months and a few days. So here's the Earth. The sun is off that way, more or less. And so, you know, half of the Earth is lit, but we're not seeing all of it from this angle. The beauty of this is that, you know, you can have an eclipse anytime. You just have to have the geometry set up. The thing is, where you are on the Earth may not be the best place to see it. If you look at this and say, oh, look, the eclipse is happening when the United States is lit up. You know, these poor suckers in I don't know, Africa, they're going to miss it. They're off the edge of the Earth that way. People in Japan and Russia and everything, they're off the Earth this way. They're going to miss it. They're not going to see it. The eclipse is happening, but they're on the wrong side of the Earth. It's like, why don't I see, where's my audience? Where'd you guys go? I don't see you. I'm facing the wrong way. Oh, here we go. So North America is facing toward the sun, and since the moon is blocking the sun, this is what you need to be able to see the eclipse. So this is what's happening at 9:25 a.m. Pacific Daylight Time. Just because that's a convenient time doesn't really matter. There we go. So now the moon is coming around, and it's starting to block more and more of the sun, and these bands are representing the darker bands of the penumbra. And that circle, the ellipse there actually, is the shadow of the moon itself. That's the umbral shadow. And as you can see, as it passes across the Earth, Salem, Boise, Casper is a direct hit. Kansas City, Nick's Kansas City, just goes just south of St. Louis, just north of Nashville, just north of Athens, and then boom, Charleston gets it too. This shadow can pass, depending on where the moon is in its orbit, you know, if the moon is perfectly lined up with the sun, yeah, you get this great eclipse going right across the Earth. Sometimes the moon is up, you know, kind of high or down kind of low, and that shadow might pass over Antarctica, it might pass over the Arctic region, whatever. It just so happens that we've got it passing over the Earth in this path here. And this is perfect. This eclipse is perfect for the United States. It passes over major cities. As the moon is going around the Earth and as the Earth is spinning, the combination of these motions is what gives you that curved path. And so it's passing over all of these major cities. These are folks who can basically sit at home and look out the window and see a total solar eclipse. That's pretty awesome. And for most of the country, it's not that far of a drive. There are tens of millions of people, I want to say 100 million people, who live within a couple of hours of this eclipse. So, New York and LA, too bad. You know, the biggest metropolises in the country, they have to go a long way. But you know what? I live here. So for me, it's a short drive. I want to show this again. Here we go. Because I want you to notice something. Look at the shape of the moon's shadow here. See how it's long and stretched out and it seems to get more and more circular as it's moving across? That's because the Earth is curved, right? So first the shadow is falling along the edge of the Earth and so it's stretched out. And then as it moves closer and closer to being right under the sun, as close as it gets to the sun's center, it becomes more circular. It's just like looking at a circle like this versus like this, and it looks more elliptical. And again, it's passing through all these regions. And again, you see the any place you see this shadow, people are going to at least see a partial eclipse. So even if you're in LA and New York, you're still going to see the moon passing at least a little bit in front of the sun. You just won't get the total eclipse effect. But that's the difference, pardon the expression, between night and day. If you don't get a total eclipse, you will not see the corona. I have seen many partial eclipses in my time. I have never seen a total solar eclipse. I am 52 years old. I am a professional astronomer. I am an amateur astronomer. I am a science communicator. I have seen many things on this green Earth of ours, but I have never seen a total solar eclipse. That better damn well change in 9 months. I'm tired of this. We had a big solar eclipse in, I want to say, 1979 when I was in high school. It missed where I grew up in Fairfax County here in Virginia, actually. I'm a native Virginian. And I had to actually watch it on TV because it was in Canada, I think, and passed over some of the U.S. But it was at least in North America, but even then, didn't see it. It was a partial solar eclipse a couple of years ago. Got a pretty good view of that. It was gorgeous. It's a lot of fun to see that because you can see the moon biting away at the sun. But unless you are inside of that red zone there, you're going to miss it. So here's another view. I love this one too. Now we're actually going to be behind the moon, looking down, sort of like with the sun behind us, looking down on the moon. So of course this is the lunar far side, the side we never see. The near side always faces the Earth. But you don't see that from here because we're looking down on the moon. And you can see here's the penumbral shadow. Here's the umbral shadow going down that cone. And now you can see it. This is pretty cool. I love this because you really get a sense of it in 3D. So we're going to pull up here, and now you can see, right, it's coming along the curvature of the Earth, and then boom, it enters the continental United States and sweeps across. The Earth is spinning this way, west to east. The moon is moving this way, too, but because we're fixed on the moon, it makes it look like the shadow is going left to right. The geometry of this is a little bit head-scratching when you first see it, but you can look this up online and figure it out if you want to. But that's going to be the path of this thing as the eclipse occurs. So if you want to see it and you want to stay home and you live here in eastern Virginia, you can't. It's not terrible. You're going to get a majority of the sun blocked. But unless you're here inside these two blue lines, that's where the physical extent of the shadow is going to be north and south. It's going to enter here, and these yellow lines represent 10 minutes. So it's going to take over an hour for the shadow to move across the Earth. The red line is the center line. That is the point of basically maximum eclipse. If you're on that red center line, that means the eclipse is going to last as long as possible. And that's because the moon in the sky appears to be a circle. And if it passes, if you're on a line where you're sort of seeing, how do I explain this? You can imagine that the moon is a circle right here. If you're on this line right here, you're only going to see the solar eclipse in such a way that the moon just barely passes over the sun, and the eclipse only lasts a few seconds. The farther down you get towards the center line, the more the eclipse is perfectly lined up, and you get the maximum amount of time that the sun is going to be blocked. For this eclipse, the maximum eclipse duration is 2 minutes and 40 seconds. We are not talking very long. The maximum an eclipse can last is actually something like 7 minutes, but huge number of things have to line. The geometry has to be right. The shadow has to fall on a certain part of the Earth. It helps if the moon is as far away from the Earth as it can be, so it's moving the most slowly. All these kinds of things have to play into it. But in this case, 2 minutes and 40 seconds, that's it. That's kind of typical for these sorts of things. There is a way to make this eclipse last longer. Can you guess? Sir, that's exactly right. You mutter in the audience indistinguishably from okay. Now, you get in an airplane. I have a friend, Glenn Schneider. Some of you may know him. He is an astronomer, works on Hubble. He has seen something like 30 eclipses now, including one in Antarctica. He actually charters planes. He has actually written software to figure out exactly where the best place is, the best flight path for an airplane to maximize eclipses. And if you fly in the direction of the eclipse, you can actually make it last quite a bit longer. Right, the Earth is spinning at, I better get this right, let's see, it's 24 hours, 24,000 miles. I guess that makes it easier. 1,000 miles an hour at the equator. I'll use imperial units for this. So up where we are, square root of 2 over 2, 700 miles an hour. So if you were flying 700 miles an hour east, you'd be going with the Earth's rotation. That's pretty fast. That's supersonic. But still, you can, you know, if you're traveling in this direction, you can actually make the eclipse last longer. If you really want to make it last longer, you should fly over western Kentucky, because that is the greatest where GE is, where it says GD, right here on the Missouri-Indiana-Kentucky border. That's the greatest duration. When you do all the math and everything and you figure out where's the eclipse lasting the longest, that's where it's going to be. So if you want it to last 2 minutes and 40 seconds, that's it. GE is actually greatest eclipse. That is when the moon is closest to being perfectly aligned between the center of the Earth and the center of the sun. So that's what that means. But anywhere on this line is fine. Basically, anywhere you are, you're going to get about 2 minutes of eclipse. So if you're thinking about taking a vacation, it's probably too late. To be honest, because we live near Wyoming, so I decided to show this path in a little bit more detail there. If you were to try to find a hotel room in Casper right now, yeah, good luck. It's almost on the center line. They're going to get 2 minutes and 30 or so seconds of eclipse. I was invited up there to give a talk, and I was very tempted just because I could get a hotel room out of it. It's really, really hard right now. Everything's been booked up for a long time. Some people are just starting to twig onto this. It's like, oh yeah, maybe I should plan this. So if you want to go, you should probably find a place that nobody's ever heard of before, like, say, Dubois. And in fact, that's where I'm going. My wife and I are driving up to a little ranch up there, and we're bringing some folks with us, and we're praying it's going to be clear. Y'all live here. You know what the weather's like in the summer. You could go to Tennessee. You could go to St. Louis. There's a pretty good chance it's going to be raining then. Wyoming's very dry. Idaho and Oregon are probably better bets. Just if you look in the almanac, the chances of it being clear around noon local time, which is when this eclipse is, are a lot better. So that's why we're going to be just north of Dubois, and we're going to get 2 minutes and 9 seconds, assuming it's not going to be cloudy. And if it's cloudy, you'll know, because you'll say, Dwight, what's that screaming I hear coming from the northwest? It's like, yeah, it's me. So You want to see the eclipse. So now you know where to go. You can, in your head, you can kind of figure out where you want to see it. You can't be in Virginia, but you can go someplace else. What are you going to see? And how are you going to, what are you going to do? You're just going to stand there and look at it? Great. Do you want to take pictures? Great. If you want to take pictures, I'm going to tell you something a good friend of mine said when I went to go see the one and only space shuttle launch I got to see. He said, don't take pictures. He said, experience it. Just stand there and experience it. And I thought, that's a really good idea. So I ignored him, and I took pictures, and the pictures came out crappy, and I missed part of the launch because of that. So when it comes to this eclipse, yeah, I'm going to take some pictures leading up to it, but once totality happens, I'm done taking pictures. I'm going to have, I'll be observing it myself. But if you want to, there are a lot of really interesting ways to take pictures. You can take a bunch of pictures of the eclipse and then stack them together to make a composite. I love these kind of shots, very clever. So this is great. If you start, I don't know, let's say at the bottom right, as you start to look up to the left, you can see the moon moving across the sun becoming a thinner and thinner sliver, and then boom, totality. And then again, as it leaves, you get the other pictures there. That's a really great way to show what's going to happen. And I know people have seen a lot of eclipses and taken pictures like that. But that the problem with that is that you're not really seeing totality. This is what totality looks like. This is my opening slide as well. This is an amazing shot taken by Luc Viateur in Belgium. I found this picture on Google, and it's Creative Commons license. This is a perfect eclipse. The moon is lined up just at the right distance from the Earth so that it perfectly blocks the sun. You can see some surface features here. There's these what are called prominences. These are towering plumes of gas that are ripped off the sun's surface by the sun's magnetic field, and these things can blow off and become coronal mass ejections where the sun blasts off these solar storms, which screw up our satellites. But when they're like this, they're just gorgeous towering loops and plumes of gas. I like that one at the top. It's actually a series of loops and very intense. And those lead off to the corona, this ethereally thin atmosphere of the sun that follows some of the sun's magnetic field lines, and you cannot see that unless you do this. You can try to do that. There are ways of sort of kind of seeing it on the Earth by putting a black disk in front of a telescope, but it doesn't work that well. You have to have something really big that blocks sunlight around you for a long way, or else basically the sky is still too bright for you to see the corona. It may look like this. Right now, the sun is heading towards magnetic minimum. There are very few sunspots. I think I heard there was one sunspot the other day. Not terribly interesting. We may not get a lot of activity. We may not see a lot of these prominences. I don't know. It could be. The sun is tempestuous and difficult to predict. So it may look like this, it may not. The corona itself may have a lot of structure to it, or it may be very smooth. It just depends on how feisty the sun is feeling that day. We will see. God, I love that shot. It just looks like there's a hole in the sun, but you're seeing the near side of the moon completely unilluminated by the sun. This is a perfect new moon. Even when the moon is typically new, it's not perfectly new, right? Because it's passing maybe a little bit above the sun. So there's a little thin crescent. You just can't see it because the sky is too bright. In this case, boom, perfect. 100% unilluminated moon that you're seeing. One thing you might want to do is pick your place wisely. If you find a place that has a bit of an interesting foreground, you can get shots like this. This is by my friend Tunk Tezel, a Turkish astronomer who travels the world taking incredible pictures of the sky, including eclipses. This is in Svalbard, Norway in 2015. He also took a series of pictures of the eclipse and made a composite of the partial eclipse leading up to this. That is a stunning, stunning picture. Like, frame it and stick that up on your wall. This is actually a composite of the foreground and the sun, but still, it shows you what's going on. And one of the things I love about this picture is the sky, right? You saw that the path of the umbra is very narrow, and the umbra itself is quite wide. And so that means if you could see like 1,000 kilometers off to the other direction, they're seeing only a partial eclipse, and so they're brightly lit. But that's what you're seeing here. This part of the sky is in the umbral shadow of the sun, but over here is the penumbra. And so the sky here is still lit by the sun. It's if you're standing over here, you're only seeing a partial eclipse. And so you're literally seeing the shadow of the moon on the sky itself. How awesome is that? You can see it in this picture too. It's not quite as obvious here, but it's darker here as you go up that way. This was in Uganda in 2013. As you can see, Tunk has gone in quite a number of places. But this one, this when Queensland, Australia, there it is, baby, right? There is the shadow of the moon on the sky. Over here, if you were standing over here, this part of the sky, you'd be seeing a partial eclipse. And you can see here, this is taken with a wide-angle lens, some equipment. Here's some folks over here looking at it. This may be my favorite eclipse picture of all. He also took this one. This is the same eclipse in Queensland with a nice telephoto lens. And there you can see the effect of you start to get a hint of the Bailey's beads, the surface of the sun shining through irregularities on the moon. Also, that pink color is real. The hydrogen in those prominences actually tends to glow characteristically in the red. And so it comes out pink in pictures. And also, it's funny, when you look at this picture, you could swear you're seeing features on the moon. Those are actually clouds. It's closer. Okay, so the problem I'm having planning for this myself personally is what I want to see. There are a lot of different ways of looking at an eclipse and a lot of different things that happen. There are these things called shadow bands, which are not terribly well understood. And if you're out like in the desert or someplace where it's very flat, you'll see these bright and dark waves that pass by very rapidly. And it's thought that may be a diffraction effect of the light hitting the moon and coming around and doing some sort of strange optical effect. But it's like waves passing over. I don't think they're terribly well understood from the reading I've made right now, that anybody knows exactly what causes these things. Probably won't see those because it's pretty rare. But another thing you can do, have you ever built a pinhole camera when you were a kid? Right? You basically take a box and you put a very small hole in one side, and that forces the light that comes through to be parallel. And so it can form an image on the back of the box. And if you have a very bright source like the sun and you aim it very carefully, you can actually see the sun on the back side of the box. One way to do that is to make the back side a frame and put like wax paper or something there. And then the sunlight comes through and forms an image of the sun on the back. This is the first kind of camera was built this way. It's pretty neat effect. I've done this myself with partial eclipses, and I've done it actually just making like an okay sign, except instead of a big hole, make it really small, and then just up against a wall, and you can see the sun that way. It's not a great way to do it, but the fact that you can do it at all is really cool. It's kind of fun to play with it. It turns out there are natural pinholes in the world, like leaves. Leaves have holes in them sometimes, and during an eclipse, the sun will shine through the leaves, and you'll get images, right? These are not shadows of leaves. These are images of the crescent sun overlapping from thousands of leaves. I love this picture. It took me a minute to figure it out. It's like, oh, this is a stucco wall. Stucco, Steve. The house we lived in had stucco. We used to call it the stucco house. That's a window. So in the window pane, you're seeing the reflection of the sun in the trees behind you. The sunlight's passing through those trees and casting these eclipses with all their little holes in them on the wall. So I love this shot. It's very artistic and shows you how good a pinhole camera can work. So if you live in a place or you're visiting a place that has a lot of trees, this would be something to keep in mind. One thing about a solar eclipse, right, is that the moon is between the sun and the earth, right? I'm just gonna throw this out there. So that when what we're seeing is the shadow of the moon cast on the earth. Now 2 weeks later, when the moon's on the other side of the Earth's shadow is cast on the moon. And so the moon becomes eclipsed. We call that a lunar eclipse. If you're standing on the moon, you would see the Earth blocking the sun. I love this. So when the Earth is between the moon and the sun, we have a lunar eclipse. When the moon is between the Earth and the sun, we have a solar eclipse. And of course, if the sun is between the moon and the Earth, you have apocalypse. I have seen... This is my friend Katie Mack. She's in Australia. She's an astrophysicist. She made this using emojis, and this got widely plagiarized on the web. And so I wanted to put this in here because it's funny, but also to give her credit. As you can see, it got a few retweets. It's a funny thing. I've seen people ask this question. It's a natural question to ask, I think. It's like, what happens if the sun gets between the moon and Earth? Well, it can't, right? The moon is orbiting the Earth, and we orbit the sun really far away. Also, there's not enough room. The sun is 1.4 million kilometers across. The moon's only 400,000 kilometers away. So, in fact, the entire Earth-Moon system could fit inside the sun. It would also suck for that to happen. But I kind of like that. But assuming we aren't fried by this apocalyptic event, it's apocalypse. I love that joke. How can you view this? There are a lot of ways of safely viewing an eclipse. When I was a kid, I heard every rumor. If you look at it, you'll go blind, right? There was the eclipse in Europe in 1999. I got a lovely email from a young woman who lived in the area, and she said that they were taking people off the streets and saying, go inside, the eclipse will kill you. It will kill you? Really? And some people say, well, the x-rays from the corona will fry your eyes. The corona, it gives off a lot of x-rays. And it's like, well, yeah, but the corona's always there, right? You just can't see it because the sun is too bright. If the sun is too bright and isn't killing me, probably the x-rays from the corona won't either, because they're not being blocked anyway. So that's not the problem. The problem is real. The problem is real. As the moon is moving in front of the sun, right, it starts to get dark. It's not really dark. It doesn't become like twilight-like until you get totality. Right before that, when there's still a sliver of the sun, your eyes actually, as it starts to get dark, your pupils in your eyes will open up. They'll dilate to let in more light. During totality, when it actually is like twilight, yeah, your pupils are going to dilate. They're going to let in more light. You can see all this great stuff. But then what happens is the moon moves off the sun, and you get that sliver on the other side again. Well, that's still really bright. That's still giving off a lot of infrared light, a lot of ultraviolet light that will get through the atmosphere and can hurt your eye. The infrared can heat your eye, and the UV can actually photolyze. Can actually change the chemistry in your retina and can give you some damage. I will say that even looking at the sun, it's really hard to damage your eye both permanently and totally. You won't go completely blind forever looking at an eclipse or even the sun. It's just a really, really dumb idea. You can be completely blinded temporarily or permanently do some small amount of damage, but not both at the same time. So you don't have to panic. However, you don't want any of that stuff to happen, especially younger folks. As you get older, your cornea becomes more yellow, and so it blocks some of that bluer ultraviolet light. It becomes easier to look at things like that. But kids, their cornea are very transparent, so you don't want them looking at that at all. There are safe ways to do it. One way is to get a pair of eclipse shades. You can order these online. They're about $1. Okay, I've got a bunch of them at home. They're made of paper. They've got rated, filtered plastic that blocks 99.whatever% of the sunlight. So you can put those on to watch the partial eclipse. When it's total, you can take them off and see the corona. If you put those things on, you can't see anything, right? The sun is the brightest thing you're going to experience, hopefully. And so if you put them on, that's all you can see is the sun. Once the eclipse becomes total, you won't be able to see anything. You take them off and look. But you have to be careful to make sure you have them on if you want to keep looking right as the eclipse ends. And so you have to know the timing of that. Another way is through a solar telescope like this one. This is the one I mentioned earlier. This is mine that I took that picture with earlier. They're a little bit pricey, but they're really cool. These also have a built-in filter. There's a filter that prevents that sunlight from ever even getting to, most of the sunlight from even ever getting to the eyepiece. So these are great, again, during the partial eclipse time. But once the eclipse becomes total, this would be like looking through a brick. You're not going to see anything. This also has a special filter which only lets through one specific color of light so you can see that magnetic activity on the sun. That's why that picture I showed you earlier was sort of red, and you could see some of that, some of those prominences and other features. These are great, and I will have mine with me up until totality, and then I'm just going to look. The same company that makes this, Lunt, L-U-N-T, there's also Coronado and a couple of others. You can find these online if you want. But this company, Lunt, is also making some binoculars called sunoculars. These are basically, they have a neutral density filter in them that blocks most of the sunlight across all colors. So you can look at the sun and watch the eclipse as it's happening. You won't get that orange color. You won't get all the fun activities, magnetic activity, but you will be able to watch the eclipse with them. This is a picture I took just fooling around when I knew there were some big sunspots on the sun using a pair of binoculars on a tripod. And basically, I blocked one of the binocular lenses so that because I was getting double images, one of the sun from each one. Blocked one so I only had one and projected it onto a piece of paper. This is the sun. Here's just a close-up of the sunspots that I wanted to see. This is the shadow of the binoculars, right? The binoculars are like this, casting these shadows here. And you can see the sun there. Or if you want to be completely safe, right? Yeah, watch it on the internet. Because everything on the internet is true. What you don't want to do, and you'll hear this, people say, oh, I used a piece of exposed film. Or I had a DVD that I held up. Or Mylar. Oh my God, don't do any of these things. These typically, while they block a lot of the visible light, will let through enough infrared to hurt your eye. And the real danger of these things is they block enough light that your pupils will dilate, letting in that dangerous radiation that these things do not block. So don't do this. And don't blame me if you go blind and you do that. Very quickly, just want to give you a few links. If you want to find out more information about the eclipse, Mr. Eclipse is the place. That is the site that is done by Fred Espenak. He has done a lot of work with NASA. The maps I was showing you earlier with the path of the sun, he did all that work. It's fantastic stuff. So just look up, you can look up his name, Fred Espenak, but Mr. Eclipse is pretty easy to remember, right? Astronomers Without Borders is one of my favorite groups. They are a not-for-profit global community of astronomers. They go around the world bringing telescopes and binoculars and showing the sky to usually underserved groups. So they go all over the place, Africa, Asia, everywhere, showing mostly kids the sky. They are wonderful. They're doing fantastic work. They sell those eclipse glasses. You can buy them in like packs of 20, but they're 20 bucks. And the money is going towards a really good cause. NASA's website, eclipse.gssc.nasa.gov. Again, Fred Espenak is behind that. Eclipse 2017 is a specific one from NASA about this upcoming eclipse. If you go to the other one, the one above it, eclipse.gssc, that has eclipses going for the next 100 years. Because of the geometry we understand, we can predict these eclipses for a long time. And then greatamericaneclipse.com is a public site, commercial site. They have a huge amount of information there too. These are all easy to remember. I see people taking pictures with their phone. That's very clever. I'm going to put this slide up again at the end just so you can see it. So let me finish up. Eclipses are amazing. Solar eclipses are amazing. You don't have to be on the Earth to see a solar eclipse. You can see them from space. This was taken in 2012. I saw one of these much earlier. This is from the Japanese satellite Hinode. This is an X-ray telescope, which is why the sun looks funny. But even from their orbit, occasionally the moon will pass in front of the sun. It looks like somebody just took a black cutout and moved it across the sun. That's because the satellite is moving so rapidly around the Earth that over the few minutes or whatever that these pictures were taken, the sun doesn't change much at all. If you look very carefully, you can see like the noise in the image changes a little bit, so you can tell it's actually real. But this only takes like two or three or 4 minutes, something like that. I love this. You can find tons of these images taken from a bunch of different satellites. Probably the better ones are like Discover, the Earth Observing satellite that was launched a couple of years ago or last year. And you can actually see the moon physically moving in front of the Earth. It's not really an eclipse, but it's still really awesome. Venus transit in 2012. There was one in 2004, then another one 8 years later in 2012. These happen in pairs, 8 years apart. And those pairs are separated by over 100 years. So if you miss the 2012 one, well, when you're 100 years old, you can see it again. I saw both. I was really pleased about that. I usually miss important astronomical events, but I got to see both. This one was taken from the Solar Dynamics Observatory, a fantastic solar telescope. It's a series of images as Venus moved across the sun. Venus, of course, orbits the sun closer than the Earth does, so it can pass directly between us, and you can get another syzygy. My tongue is getting tired from doing all this talking. The other planet closer to the sun is Mercury, And so you can get a Mercury eclipse, too. Remember, these are called transits. Nobody really calls them eclipses, but what the heck. These are actually interesting events in that if you know the timing of them and you can exactly time when the planet first touches the sun and moves across and leaves it again, you measure that time, you can actually calculate the distance to that planet. And a long time ago, we didn't know how far away the planets were. Newton and Kepler figured out the relative distances. We knew, for example, that Mercury was something like 0.3 times the distance of the sun that the Earth is. But we didn't know how far away the Earth was from the sun. If you time these things, you can calculate that. There were huge expeditions set up to go and observe Venus moving across the sun back in the 1700s and 1800s to try to figure this out. The goal of everything was to figure out the distance of the Earth to the sun. And they did this, and they were able to get it The problem is there are optical effects and atmospheric effects that make it impossible to do this super accurately. And it wasn't until the 1960s, when we had radar and we could bounce them off of other planets so we could get their exact distances. So that to me is amazing. We really didn't know how far away the Earth was from the sun with any real accuracy until just 50 years ago. But this was a huge deal 100, 200 years ago. So there was real science to be done with these things. There also can be cool. Terry Legault is a Belgian astronomer. I see some people nodding their heads. This guy is a freaking wizard. He's a magician. He uses software to calculate where certain events are going to happen. He goes there and photographs it. That is a series of video frames. He takes video of the space station, the International Space Station, hence my weird title there, moving across the sun. He's done this several times. He's also taken pictures of the shuttle and Hubble and the Chinese space station moving across the sun. Phenomenal photographer. The amount of planning that goes into this is pretty amazing. You can't miss by much. Or else you can't, I mean, you can't be in the wrong spot on the Earth by very much, literally kilometers, or else you'll miss this. So this is just for fun, but it turns out there is huge science. I mean, a solar eclipse these days is just an amazing event, just. But it's not necessarily something you can get a lot of science from. There is some, but not a huge amount. There is science you can get from this, and that, of course, I should say, exoplanets, right? The exact same thing with the Venus and Mercury transits happen around other stars. They have planets that pass in front of the stars. They block a little bit of the sunlight, starlight, I should say, and you can measure that. And that's how we know that these exoplanets exist. I was working on Hubble during that time, when this was first done in 1995, basically, and kind of blew me away. We wound up getting some data of one of these things and actually being able to see its atmosphere as the sunlight, as the starlight passed through the planet's atmosphere. You can detect it absorbing certain wavelengths, certain colors of the light. We know about thousands of these things because they pass directly between us and their star. It's an interstellar syzygy. Man, I'm having more trouble. Let's see. Let's try it this way. Syzygy. There we go. That's better. And you know, you can find other worlds this way. And there's one more thing. One more thing. The sun is 400 times bigger than the moon, and it's 400 times farther away. And do the math. Those two things cancel. The size of an object depends on how big it is and how far away it is. If you double its distance, it's half as big. If it's 10 times farther away, it's a tenth as big. Because the sun is 400 times bigger and 400 times farther away, the sun and the moon are roughly the same size. Now, the Earth's orbit's an ellipse, so sometimes the sun looks a little bit bigger, sometimes smaller. The moon's orbit is an ellipse, sometimes it looks bigger, sometimes it looks smaller. But it just so happens that if things are right, you get an eclipse. Sometimes the moon's a little bit bigger, you don't see as much as the corona. Sometimes the moon is farther away from the Earth, it doesn't block the sun, and you get that annular eclipse like I mentioned. So it's a coincidence. You can look at the other planets and, you know, Venus, Mercury doesn't have a moon, Venus doesn't have a moon. Mars has two moons, but they're small, and so they don't block the sun completely. They look more like this, more like a transit. Some of the moons, like Jupiter and Saturn, are the right distance and right size to get a total eclipse, but they don't have solid surfaces. I mean, Jupiter and Saturn. If you were floating in the clouds, if you had a balloon, a dirigible, I suppose, you might be able to see a total eclipse. But the Earth is the only planet where its moon and the sun are the right size in the sky where you can stand and look up and see an eclipse. It's coincidence. How do I know it's coincidence? Because we know the moon is moving away from the Earth. Every year, the moon is about that much farther from the Earth than it was the year before. It has to do with tides and gravity and the way the Earth and the moon interact, but over time, the moon is moving away. If you do the math, and the math is hard, but if you do it, you'll find that roughly about a few hundred million to a billion years ago, the moon was so big in the sky, it was so close, that it blocked most of the corona. And if you look a few hundred million years, billion years in the future, the moon will have moved away so far that no matter what, you will never get a solar eclipse again, not a total one. Every eclipse will be annular. Some will be thinner than others, but they will all be annular. We live in the middle of an eclipse season. So people say, oh, the Earth is special for having eclipses. No, it's not. However, we live at the right time for that to happen. And you might say, well, aren't we special again? It's like, well, it's a season that's a billion years long, and the Earth's only 4 billion years old. So it's not that big of a coincidence. Look, I flipped a coin. It's heads. Oh, my gosh, what are the odds? Well, you know, 50-50. So, you know, one out of four odds aren't that bad. Some people like to say we're special because of this. No, I wouldn't argue that. Doesn't change anything. People who have seen a total solar eclipse say it's the most amazing thing they've ever seen. They put it up there in their lives with getting married and having a kid. I mean, I don't know if I'd do that because I don't want to get divorced. But they tell you it is life-changing. It is one of the most awe-inspiring and beautiful, magnificent things you will ever see. When I look at pictures like this and I think about what I know about the sky and having observed it all my life and never having seen one of these things, I have to believe them. 9 months from now, I know that my life is going to change. I hope yours does too. If you get a chance to go see this, go see it. And in the meantime, again, check out those links. And again, thank you very much. Mm. Oh, there we go. Now I can say Syzygy easily. Syzygy. Yes.
With that,
yes.
You can also get number 14 welding shade.
Yeah, apparently welder's glasses are good, and you have to get, but you said it's level 14?
14.
Because I know there's like different grades of them, and some people get the wrong kind, so I tend not to mention it. But yes, that also works. The link's up here. If you go to Mr. Eclipse, he has a whole page on how to observe the eclipse safely. He also has a page on how to photograph it. In fact, Fred has written a book that's coming out very soon. Has a brilliant foreword. You figuring that out? Yeah, I wonder who wrote it. But it's a really great book about this eclipse too. It's coming out very soon. I think in a month. I'm not sure. But keep your eyes open for that. I read it. It's really good. It has a lot of personal stories about. About the eclipse, and they talk about how to view it and how to photograph it. It's not trivial. Taking a picture of the sun and the moon together is very hard. They're very small in the sky. You don't think that, but they are. And getting pictures of them is tough. So read up and practice. If you want to get pictures of this, go out and take pictures of the moon first and figure out how to set things up, because it's not going to be easy.
Did you ever see any albedo during totality?
Albedo? What do you mean?
From the Earth.
So Earthshine. Yeah, so I guess you could. I don't see why not. When the moon is between the Earth and the sun, the Earth is still, as you saw from the maps, right? Most of the Earth is still being lit up. That light is being reflected off into space. Some of that's going to hit the moon. Yeah, I guess you should. I mean, very little of the Earth is being blocked by the moon. Just like 1% or 2%, something small like that. So I guess you should, but you don't usually see it in pictures. In that one picture I showed, I really thought that like you're seeing Mare Crisium and a couple of these other places on the moon, but then I convinced myself they're clouds, but now that you've said that, I'm not so sure.
You can always see a lot of albedo with a crescent moon.
Yeah, just the other day when the moon was a thin crescent, there was some. It's called Earthshine. It's also called the new moon in the old moon's arms. I love that. That's so poetic. But you can see sort of the dark side of the moon, and it's being illuminated by light reflected off the Earth. If it's cloudy on the Earth, right? Clouds reflect a lot of light. So if it's very cloudy, you can get a lot more earth shine. But if it's cloudy where you are, you don't see any because it's cloudy where you are. So I'm kind of hoping we don't see it for this eclipse because I want it to be clear everywhere as much as possible so people can see it. And by people, I mean me. Me, I want to see this, which is why we're going to Wyoming specifically. I looked at an almanac and figured out where is it most likely to be clear at that time of day, at that time of year. Hopefully, we'll see it. Yes, everybody on the right side has questions. Come on, stage left. You have to.
One question.
Yeah.
The moon is moving away from the Earth, but this orbit. What about the Earth's orbit around the Sun? Is it getting bigger or smaller?
I want to say it's getting bigger. it's hard to measure. The Sun is losing mass because it's blowing off the solar wind. It's also losing mass because it's converting 500 million tons of hydrogen into helium. It's converting. I've got the numbers wrong. Wait a minute. 700 million? 700 million tons of hydrogen to helium every second. 5 million tons is converted into energy of that, I think. So the Sun is losing several million tons of mass every second of its life. The Sun has a lot of mass, so it's not that big of a deal. But because it's losing mass, its gravity is getting weaker and the Earth is moving away. But that takes so long that I don't think it's a big effect. That does make the Sun smaller, and that means that's competing with the Moon moving away because the Moon's becoming smaller. So that helps. That extends the eclipse season. I don't know how much, though. It turns out that gets really complicated. The Moon is moving away from the Earth, but as it does so, the Sun's influence on the Moon gets stronger, and that's going to affect the orbit. I've read that eventually the Moon will start moving back toward the Earth. But I'm not sure about the timing of that. If it takes more than 6 billion years, doesn't matter anyway, because then the Sun's going to expand into a red giant and cook us. If you want to worry about this, have at it. But I have other plans for 6 billion years from now. I'm going to be very busy.
With that, we're going to...
Is that it? Okay.
Corralling in for right now. I would like to say that Phil brought his A game and all the passion you saw was just for this audience, but he's like this 24/7.
That's kind of true.
Okay. But with that, we have a plaque to commemorate your participation in our colloquia series.
Oh, cool.
And also remember, everybody, 7 o'clock tonight at the Air and Space Center is the Sigma Series lecture. Totally different talk, so you can see him.
7:30. That's Death from the Skies, Asteroid Impact.
So he'll still be wound up then, and you can see him.
Yeah, I have movie clips. That'll be fun.
And an asteroid.
Yeah, I have a meteorite. I'm much more snarky for that talk than this one. Yeah. This is gorgeous. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. And let's thank Phil one more time. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody. Oh, this is really cool.